Hi everyone, this talk will be recorded for Crypto 2020. Here we revisit the question of constructing lattice-based blind signatures. This is joint work with Eike Kiels, Julian Loss and Kahn Yuen.
A blind signature scheme is an interactive protocol between two parties, a signer and a user. The signer takes as input a secret key, the user a public key as well as a message M. The key pair PKSK is output by some Keygen function and message M is an arbitrary bit string. In this work, we considered a special case where the interaction consists of three moves. At the end of the interaction, the user learns a signature sigma on a message of its own choice and the signer is supposed to learn nothing. Further, a public verify algorithm V is defined, which on input a message signature pair, as well as a public key, will either output accept or reject. Blind signatures come with two security properties, one more unforgeability and blindness. In the blindness experiment, the adversary takes the role of a malicious signer. Intuitively, the adversary should be blind to which message was used in a specific interaction, as well as the produced signature. In the one more unforgeability security experiment, also called OMUF, the adversary takes the role of a malicious user. The intuitive goal of the adversary is to forge a new signature on its own. In contrast to plain digital signatures, the existential unforgeability against chosen message attack security experiment is not applicable here. Since, during the simulation of signatures to the adversary, the experiment does not learn the signed messages. Therefore, the experiment has to keep track of the number of interactions and thus the number of signatures the adversary may learn. In the end, the adversary has to produce a one more forgery. Blind signatures have various applications in privacy-related protocols, such as e-voting, e-cash, and anonymous credentials. Since our scheme can be instantiated by lattice assumptions, it is post-quantumly secure. One can subdivide post-quantumly secure schemes into two distinct sets. On the one hand side, we have schemes from generic complexity assumptions, and on the other hand side, efficient schemes with a concrete security treatment. The works listed here are representatives for a whole body of work. In the concrete, non-postquantum setting, we have the seminal work of Poincheril and Stern, Journal of Cryptology 2000. They give the first proof of the Okamoto-Schnorr blind signature scheme, which is based on the discrete logarithm assumption. This assumption can be broken by a quantum computer. In the generic, non-postquantum setting, we have Jules, Loewi and Ostrowski, Crypto 97. In their construction, they use one-way trapdoor permutations. It is not clear how to instantiate them from a post-quantumly secure assumption. In the intersection of generic and post-quantum, we have Fischlin, Crypto, 2006. He gives a construction for blind signatures, which uses a public key encryption scheme, a commitment scheme, and a non-interactive zero-knowledge proof, of which all three are instantiable from lattice assumptions. In the intersection of concrete and post-quantum, we have Rückert, AsiaCrypt 2010. Rückert's work is the first concrete lattice-based construction for blind signatures. His construction is based on the hash function by Lubashevsky and Michiancho. In this intersection, lots of related work builds upon the proof ideas of Rückert. Unfortunately, as we show in our first contribution, this initial work is flawed, and thus, all subsequent work also suffers from the same flaw. This clears the field for our second contribution, a construction for lattice-based blind signatures. Three-move blind signature schemes are susceptible to the so-called ROS attack against the OMUF security, where ROS stands for random inhomogeneities in an overdetermined solvable system of linear equations. The ROS attack can be seen as a specific attack against the OMOF security of three move blind signature schemes. It works roughly as follows. The attacker takes the role of the user in the OMOF experiment. The first thing the attacker does is to request L first messages, R1 to RL, thus opening L parallel sessions with the signer. Next, the attacker uses these L values R1 to RL to compute a solution consisting of two parts. The first part is a vector of L challenge value C1 to CL, which the attacker will send over to the signer individually. The attacker will now receive L responses S1 to SL. From these L responses S1 to SL, the ROS attacker finally computes L plus 1 signatures. The bigger the value L, the more information the attacker receives, and hence, the easier the task of the adversary to break the scheme using the ROS attack. If L is too small, then the task of the ROS attacker becomes information theoretically hard. If the blind signature scheme is the one by Okamoto Schnorr, whose hardness is based on the discrete logarithm problem, then the ROS attack is actually feasible. In a work which recently appeared on ePrint by Ben Hamuda, Lepore, Orr, and Rajkova, they show that if L gets large enough, then the ROS attacker finds a solution in polynomial time. In the latter setting, the concrete hardness of the ROS problem for large L is not known. In Poincaré and Stern's original proof for the Okamoto-Schnorr blind signature scheme, the parameters are chosen such that the ROS attack is information theoretically hard. In the lattice-based blind signature scheme by Rückert, some parts of the proof techniques introduced by Poincaré and Stern were reused. However, the proof does not take the possibility of the ROS attack into account, and in particular, does not set the parameters such that the ROS attack gets information theoretically hard. This roughly shows the problem in the security proof of Rückert's lattice-based blind signature scheme. The main technical ingredient in Poincaré-Stern's proof to show that for small l the ROS attack is information theoretically infeasible is the forking lemma. It gives a lower bound on the success probability of executing an algorithm twice on partially dependent uniform randomness in the shared state. In 2000, Poincaré and Stern introduced forking proofs for signatures and blind signatures. In 2006, Bilar and Neven give a generalization. Their version only estimates the probability of both runs being successful. In the context of blind signatures, this is on its own not sufficient. For three-move blind signatures, an additional argument on the distributions of the outputs is needed. In 2019, Haug, Kills and Loss give a further generalization which also allows to argue on the distributions of the outputs. Our first contribution is to point out flaws in the work of Rückert, Blaise, Balatkadri, Banzahani and Buchmann, which appeared in this year's Financial Crypto, and others. There, we show that an unsound application of the Bilar-Neven forking lemma leads to a flaw in the OMOF proof. Specifically, an argument on the output of the forked algorithm is missing. Thus, the security statement becomes uncertain. Yet, we do not give a concrete attack. Our second contribution is a generalization of the modular framework presented in HKL19. They show how to construct blind signatures from a special type of hash function. We extend that framework to the case of correctness errors, whereas HKL19 consider the error-free setting. In the latter setting, blind signature schemes come along with some kind of correctness error. We say a scheme has correctness error delta if for all messages m, the probability that the verify algorithm will output reject is bounded by delta. The random choices are drawn over an honest execution of the scheme. The framework of HKL19 defines the two following transformations. From a linear hash function, they construct a linear identification scheme. From that, they construct a linear blind signature scheme. In this work, we start with a linear hash function with noticeable and closeness error. Then closeness error is a notion closely related to correctness error. From that, we construct a linear identification scheme with negligible correctness error. Finally, from that, we construct a linear blind signature scheme also with negligible correctness error. A linear hash function is defined by three sets: a set of scalars S, a domain D, and a range R, where D and R are S modules. Let F be a map from the domain to the range. We require F to be a module homomorphism, meaning that F preserves addition and scalar multiplication. Further, we require the kernel of F to be non-trivial, implying that F is compressing. Finally, F is required to be collision resistant. In the OMOF proof, we reduce the hardness of breaking the OMOF security to the hardness of finding collisions in F. For every variable defined in the scheme, we define a filter set, which is a subset of either the set of scalars S or the domain D. From the filter sets, we require the enclosedness property. We say, a linear hash function is delta enclosed if the addition and scalar multiplication of certain variables lies in a specific filter set. This relates to the correctness error of the blind signature scheme. The better this probability, the smaller the correctness error. Further, we require smoothness from the filter sets. We say, a linear hash function is smooth if computations of certain variables are identically distributed to certain other variables drawn uniformly at random from some other set. This property is crucial for the blindness proof. The first transformation of our framework turns linear hash functions into linear identification schemes with correctness error. The Keegan algorithm samples a secret key uniformly at random from its respective filter set and sets the public key to be f of sk. The signer starts by sampling r uniformly at random from its respective filter set. Here, the index I denotes that the assignment is repeated for all values where I is defined. Next, the signer applies f to all values r in order to get a vector of values capital R. Then, the signer sends this vector to the user. The user now samples the challenge uniformly at random from its respective filter set and sends it over to the signer. The signer then calculates S as C scalar multiplied with SK plus R. Here, the circular arrow denotes that this operation is repeated until S is in its respective filter set. Without this check, value S may leak information about the secret key. With high probability, this check will be true for at least one value R. Thus, by choosing an appropriate dimension of vector R, we achieve negligible correctness error. The signer ends its execution by sending S over the channel. At the end, the user checks whether there exists some I such that f of s equals to c scalar multiplied by pk plus f of r. If this is true, the execution of the identification scheme is correct. The simplified idea in constructing the signature scheme is to set the signature to be the transcript. The verify algorithm of the blind signature scheme will then test whether the transcript is a result of a valid interaction. However, this contradicts blindness, since it's trivial to deduce from the signature which interaction it was produced in. So, we need to blind the transcript. Since the first component of the signature is an n-dimensional vector, this leaves us with huge signatures. To mitigate this, we will use hash trees. Hash trees, also called Merkle trees, were first used in the context of lattice-based blind signatures in the work Blaze Plus. A hash tree is a binary tree data structure where a list of values, here r'1 to r'4, are hashed together to get a single hash value, the root of the tree. The leaves of the binary tree are the hashed values. To get the hash value of the parent, both children nodes are hashed together. This step is repeated until the root of the tree is reached. Anticipating the usage of hash trees in the final blind signature scheme, we continue as follows. The first part of the signature consists of values such that a single value are prime, and thus a leaf of the tree can be recomputed. The second part of the signature consists of the minimal number of nodes needed to be able to reconstruct the root. To generate the subset of the tree, an additional algorithm built auth is introduced. For the sake of an example, let r'3 be the value recoverable from the first part of the signature. Thus, the authentication path consists of h4 and h5. Now, for the second part of our framework. Here, we turn linear identification schemes with correctness error into linear blind signature schemes with correctness error. The Keegan algorithm stays the same. The sinusoid stays also the same, so we can safely ignore that for now. But the user side changes significantly. Instead of drawing a challenge uniformly at random, the user proceeds as follows. First, the user draws two vectors of blinding parameters alpha and beta. Alpha will be used to blind the third part of the transcript, beta to blind the second. Vector r' is calculated such that exactly one value r' can be reconstructed from the blinded second and third part of the transcript. Then the hash tree is constructed. Next, the first part of the signature, c', is calculated as the hash of the root of the tree in message m. Value c' now gets unblinded to get the second part of the transcript. The circular arrow denotes that this calculation is repeated until a j is found such that c is in its respective filter set. This guarantees that no information about c' is leaked by the second component of the transcript. After the signer returns s, the user performs the same test which already can be found at the end of the identification scheme. The value of variable I is necessary to identify the index of value r', which can be reconstructed from the signature. Next, the user calculates the second part of the signature, s', by blinding the third part of the transcript. The circular arrow denotes that the calculation is repeated until the value k is found such that s' is in its respective filter set. This check guarantees that no information about s' is leaked by the third part of the transcript. Finally, the user computes the last part of the signature, an authentication path for exactly that value r', which can be reconstructed from c' and s'. The simplified verify algorithm will check whether c' equals the hash of root and m. We formulate the following security statements. If a linear hash function is collision resistant, then the first transformation yields a one more man in the middle secure identification scheme, where the latter security notion is an intermediate notion natural to linear identification schemes. Further, if a linear identification scheme fulfills this notion, then the second transformation yields an OMOV secure blind signature scheme. Additionally, if a linear hash function is smooth, then the resulting blind signature scheme is blind. For our framework, we provide a sample instantiation based upon the hash functions of Lubachevsky and Michiancho. The underlying assumption is the hardness of the ARSIS problem. Here, the size of the prime is approximately 2 to the power of 1890. Our signatures are roughly 36 megabyte, and the signing speed is probably quite slow due to the size of the prime. Further, the maximum number of signatures per issued key pair is polylogarithmic in the security parameter. This is due to the security exponentially degrading in the number of issued signatures. Only in this range, the ROS problem is information theoretically hard. So, all in all, the practicability is quite low. To conclude, we give a modular framework for lattice-based blind signatures with negligible correctness error, sound blindness and OMOF proofs. However, the instantiation is quite improvable. So as open problems we see, a more efficient instantiation and also cryptanalysis of the generalized ROS problem. If there's something I want you to take away from this talk, it's the following. Take care with forking proofs for blind signatures. They turn out to be quite tricky, especially in the lattice setting. Thanks for your attention.